works at Sortable.
That is correct.
And so he's going to talk about today about paper called Tiling and Playing with Congruent and Pentagons. It's a paper from 1978, so it's pretty old actually.
Not enough magic.
But it's still impressive, right?
It doesn't have the latest result on
Pentagons. No, because you couldn't find it, and so in that paper is discussion about strategies about how you can form Congruent Pentagons that will completely overlap the plane. So indeed, you don't want to have overlap, and you also don't want to have gaps.
This was prompted by the announcement a few weeks ago of the 15th Pentagon known to tile the plane, the discovery of the 15th Pentagon. That number 15 is a bit of a lie. So if you're thinking like one day you're going to be rich and you're going to get a house with 15 bathrooms and tile the floors with like one with each of the 15 Pentagons, that's not really going to work out because there's infinite again, first of all. It's a lie in a couple ways. One way is that it's 15 types. Right? So this one, for example, has a lot of flexibility, near. This thing can do all kinds of different things. This still counts as one Pentagon. This is one type, you see. So it's a lot.
Feel free to cross the screen.
Yeah. Let me tell you about some Pentagons. This is type number one. Made out of cutting a hexagon in two, if you like. And the hexagons have lines, and symmetric hexagons. So the only constraint here is that you have two sides that are parallel. Then you can build this. Then when you spin rotated by 180 degrees, it'll line up and make straight lines, and then you'll have the hexagon, which is centrally symmetric, and that tiles the plane. And the usual second plane. Everything's great. Great, so that's number one. Number two comes from putting a two in the interval.
Yeah. Why haven't they thought of this?
This is my research project. So this one, this is kind of cool. I like that. This is footsteps, if you will. It's a symmetry here. Right? This is your right foot, left foot, right foot, left foot, right foot, like that. And then there's somebody else walking the other way, and this is what I carry you, and so on. So the constraints for this to work are a little more complicated. That's why there's a circle and these weird lines in here. One thing is that the heel and the toe have to be the same length, because they're going to match up, the toe. And then the other thing is this angle and this angle have to add up to 180 degrees, so it'll form this straight line. That angle is this one on the other foot. So these two have to add up to 180 degrees. And one way to represent that geometrically is to make them opposite angles in a cyclic quadrilateral. So if you extend the opposite sides over here, we get this point, and we'll go through that, those three points, and you get a nice little circle there. And then if you move this around to make different shaped feet, you see the circle will, slowly circular. So, yeah, you can make this look a whole bunch of different ways. My program does not pay any attention to the convexity constraint, so you can get some rather odd
Pentagons.
Things, yeah. Okay, that looks good. Alright, so that's type number two. That's kind of cool. Oops. That's kind of cool. Type two. Type three is you can top up a hexagon into three slices, three pie slices. Okay. This is very suitable because we're bowl made.
Branding.
Let me pander to my sponsor here.
Very suitable.
Type 4, this one I'm sure has been on for 10,000 years because, you can just make a plus sign, make those plus signs and then cut them up into four chunks and those are pentagons and then plus sign, plus sign, plus sign and tile a plane. Hey, but that one can look kind of more on the way flower, which is nice. You can make it look like you can ignore the convexity constraints again. You also see it a lot in bricks. In this form, when it generates into a quadrilateral, many times, where you can puff them up. Actually, this one's quite nice. Do this, because now it looks like two hexagonal tiling superimposed. Okay. The hexagon here, and the next hexagon of that tiling there, and then you have the same time that you rotate the 90 degrees here, and here. You superimpose those and they fit each other up into four pieces, which is kind of cool, I guess. What else about that? Bricks. Those good. Where's that step number four? Type number five. Do a nice little floral pattern. Hexagonal floral pattern. It's kind of nice. You can make it more symmetrical if you want. Like that. Make it less symmetrical if you want. You can ignore the convexity constraint. You can do the alien structure in space. Okay, so there's that. Okay, so. Now, the same many of these have probably been known for tens of thousands of years. These five were cataloged for the first time in 1918, apparently, by Reinhardt. This was the first effort to be systematic and find all the Pentagons that did this, according to a paper that's read by Doris Schachner in 1978. These five are the only five which are so the only tiles which are convex, pentagonal, and tile transitive. I'll explain what tile transitive means for the tiling in a minute by looking at a counter example, which is type number six. Now you might wonder, okay, this is the beginning of the story for pentagons. What about other shapes? Okay, triangles, they can always tile the plane, they're not very interesting. Quadrilaterals, it turns out, can always tile the plane, not very interesting. Okay, then after that, pentagons, which is here, hexagons, apparently have a slightly more complicated story. Sometimes they can, sometimes they can't, and there's references for that in the paper. Seven or more, it can't be done with convex. And, well, it's kind of celebrating, but what you do is you say, because by convexity, when you have three of the, we're going to prove it's impossible to tile a plane with convex heptagons, let's say, or higher number of sides, by computing the average angle in two different ways, and we'll discover that the two answers are not consistent with each other. Right? So one way to do it is you just count by the internal angles of tile, and then you average over all the tiles. And that's one thing. So, I mean, you know, it's a heptagon, so now I'm gone, you can compute the internal angle. It turns out it has to be more than 120 degrees. For the, on the other hand, when some come together at a vertex, there have to be at least three because they're convex. Okay? And then that means that the angle, the average around that vertex has to be at least 120 degrees. So, and then you average over all the vertices of the tiling, and yeah, they can't be both greater than and less than 120 degrees. Now, there's a technical problem about how do you average over all of the tiles exactly? And there's some actual technical difficulties in there, but we'll just figure out. I'm pretty sure if we go look on Stack Overflow, there's someone giving the answer that I just gave, but and then be challenged in the comments, saying, but how do you take the average? Because there's apparently tilings where these averages do not exist, which is interesting. But I think you can get around it by assigning just a different probability distribution to the tiles. Anyway. Okay, so there's can be done with seven or up, with six that's solved, and I don't know. Three and four are more, and five is with five. So, you might hope that these are the only five. The only five tiles, that is not the case. They are the only five convex and tile transitive, but in 1968, someone named Kirchner had another look at the question and discovered type number six, which I think is quite pretty, actually. Isn't that pretty? Nobody? Nobody agrees?
I think it's pretty.
Thank you. So, here's it looking a little more pedestrian. So here it says hexagonal. It's a hexagonal tiling, but cut, instead of cutting them all the same way like we did in the first one, you've got alternating way. So, I mean, in that form it's kind of boring, but yeah, it looks prettier, I guess. There's some other non-convexity. We ignore non-convexity, as we are fans of convexity, I guess. So the interesting thing about number six, it's the first one that we have where the tiling is not, the symmetry group of the tiling is not transitive on tiles. So in the previous ones, there are, of course, symmetries. Meaning you can pick up the tiling and put it down, move it around and put it down in a different way. Yeah? Say this one, you can rotate around this point by 60 degrees, and then this tile will move there, this tile will move there, this one there, this one there. These one, this will move there, that will move there, I guess, and everything will rotate. And you do that to the whole plane, and the tiling will be unchanged afterwards. Every tile will move on to some other tile, and it will be the same as it was before. Okay, that's great. Moreover, if you, I mean, you can do that many different ways. You don't have to rotate here, you can also like, translate over there, and there's a zillion
more symmetry group. Moreover, if you pick any two tiles, say this one and this one, there will be a symmetry which takes that one to that one. This is meaning transitivity. So in this case, I mean, they have the same shape, and so you expect that there's a, you can move this tile there. What's important is that the rest of the tiling respects that operation also, as it turns out. Another way to look at it is to say the symmetries of the tiling are such that if you live in this tile world, and then we blindfolded you and spun you around and walked you around the block a few times, and then took the blindfold off, you wouldn't be able to tell whether you'd actually moved or not. And because the tile that you were on at the end of that looks the same locally from sitting in it as any other tile. All tiles look the same. However, in this tile number of type 6, do you understand? That is not the case. These come in pairs, like this one and this one. I mean, it's possible to move this tile to be on top of that tile, but if you do that, you'll ruin the rest of the tile. You'll ruin that little chain, right? If you rotate like this, that's what you have to do. Where does this one go? It has to end up in here, and it'll overlap this. It's different from what the tile we're looking at right now. Okay, so you would be able to tell if you move from here to there. You would know something was different, because that tile wouldn't be there. It turns out that it is transitive on these pairs. If you put these two together, those two together, those two together, those two together, and those two together, and those two together. And so you have this nice, these two, and then the same ones opposite. And it is transitive on those objects, on these pairs. So if you pick, like, I want these two to go to these two, then you can transfer the whole thing and everything else will be preserved. And that will work out. So it's not explained in the paper what Reinhardt, the person who cataloged the first five, it's not clear what method they use or whether they were really assuming that the thing should be tile transitive or not. I'm not sure what the deal is there. Kirshner's method obviously did not assume tile transitive, being found a few more. Found this one, number 6, also number 7, which is another similar one where there's a, you can pair them up, and that's obvious way, and then I'll address it. This is, I'm going to mark and drink it. Again, this is another one where you might have addressed these things. Okay, I believe it like that.
This one's very scaly.
The scaling? Oh, I lost the scaling. This?
Yeah.
That's very metal.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Kirchner found that, and number 8. Which is another. Actually, I really like this one because it's like cutting up the hexagons again, except you also dent the hexagons. Right? You push this out, you push this in, push that out, and push this in. Before that, it was an hexagon, and then you doubled up those. Well, now it's a decorative one, I guess. And then you tile, but now because you, it's actually not just a translation of the hexagon down here. You have to flip it so that the convexity concavity will line up. So that's part of the head. Or if you don't like looking at it like that, you can make it look like this. This is more like a house, or a house falling over, stacked on top of each other. Okay, so that was in 1968. Kirshner published that, and thought it was complete. All of these new tilings are edge to edge, which is nice, meaning that whenever two tiles touch, if they touch at all, or touch at more than a point, then they share a whole edge. It's kind of tidy. But these last three are not, the tilings are not tile transitive. So at this point, Martin Gardner intervenes. It's paper, a column for Scientific American, 1975, publicizing this result. A bunch of amateurs get involved and say, oh no, there's more tilings. One of them is tile number 9, which I screwed up. I ran out of time this weekend trying to put all these into nice form. And as you see, this one I screwed up. Yeah. I was assuming, when I was making this, I was working on the assumption that it was a two-dimensional configuration space. It's not, it's a one-dimensional configuration space. So I'm not free to choose two angles the way that I wanted, and with the result that you see. This one was discovered by Marjorie Rice, who was very prolific in this area. So she found this one, she found another batch. Let me show you those figures in the actual paper, because they're quite nice looking. Yeah, there's a batch of 3 that she found a little while later, at the top here. Let me just zoom that in. You can see it. Ignore this thing up at the top, the upper left, just the other 3 tilings here. Yeah, so we've got lunch. Apparently the methods here were almost everybody's method was essentially to try to do a systematic search, but in the days before computers it was very easy to start a systematic search and not finish it. And overlook a case, or forget something, or make a hidden assumption. James is another person, Richard James III, apparently another amateur who did some work on this after Gardner's columns published, and found these two in the middle, which are quite nice, also not tile transitive. That's perhaps obvious. You can tell if you're inside one of those octagonal things or not, or if you're in one of the bow tie stripes. It is transitive on three shape blocks. You put three things together, and you get it's transitive on those, apparently. And the discovery of this one actually turned out to be a hidden assumption in Kirchner's search, the person who found 6, 7, and 8. Yeah, but that search assumed that the tiling would be etched to edge, or if not, there was some additional little condition that was assumed when the tiling was not etched to edge, which was mysterious. Not totally different. So, there are a bunch more. Now, this comes up, so at the time this paper was published, there were 13. A couple years later, Marjorie Rice found 14th. Which was published in a very short note in I forget where, in the same paper, same journal as this name, F-1920Z. And then many years passed, and then someone discovered 15. Now, it's number 15 I want to come back to because it's a lie. First of all, it's a lie because many of them have some degree of freedom, right? As we've been seeing, maybe they can flex and have different shapes. Okay, that's okay. You think, man, maybe they're basically saying, no, the problem is, one of the big problems is that these things overlap. These classes overlap. So for example, if you take this type 1, which has these two parallel sides, and that's all that it requires to have a tile like this, then we look at the type 2, for example, and you say, well, I can make two of these sides parallel, can't I? Just by putting this in here. No, that looks roughly parallel. Yeah. So, and this is a different tile than the one that we had before, than the type 1. Then the type 1, what you would do is rotate this around by 180 degrees and make a pentagon there, but these things, this is not that rotated by 180 degrees, it's that reflected and translated. So this is a different tile. This tile has this. To my way of thinking, it's of a different type, because it supports both these tiles. It's worse than that, much worse than that, is if you look at the paper, there are a zillion, approximately, on page 34, I think. I forget. Yes. So this type number one, which they just call one type of pentagon, the tiles of the plane, actually, if it satisfies additional conditions, like it satisfies that the two sides that are parallel are actually equal, then you get another four. And if it satisfies the two different sides are equal, then you get another one. And in the middle, you get quite a few. There are a lot of tiles of pentagons. So there's a real, I think, difficult question about what you consider, how many pentagons are there at the tile of the plane, other than the silly answer is infinitely many. Or the silly answer, which is some. It's not clear that 15 is the right answer. I think you can justify 15, but it's a little bit wonky how you do that. And worse than all of this is that there are ones which are worst thing ever. There are ones whose symmetry group, okay, so this one on the right, this symmetry group is just for rotations. It has no translations in the symmetry group. This offends me. Is it not right? Not accept this. You need to have a wallpaper group. This is my favorite. You should have a wallpaper group as your symmetry group where you don't count. Okay? This is terrible. This one, so each of these, I think it's dividing up here. So this strip and this strip, those are the same, but then these two you see have been flipped. But they actually have the same silhouette. So you can stack them up and choose in each band arbitrarily, so you get infinitely many tilings just from that. Okay, for this one. And different, all different. And all different, irregular if you want, no symmetry group. Except maybe translating this way. Anyway. That also offends me. I hate that. That's terrible. Okay, so the 15 is a lie. That's the most important thing I want to tell you. And there are a lot of pentagons that tell the plane. And I'm going to make a computer game about this. My idea is, you'll just have a pentagon, it'll start regular, and you choose the tiling that you want, just by number or something. And then you have to, it'll it'll try to complete the tiling for you, but it won't work because the pentagon is the wrong shape. So you have to adjust the shape of the pentagon, and then as you adjust it, it'll try to follow the rules of the tiling. It's going to be awesome. You wait and see. All you people who don't believe in me. And in my pentagon game. You'll be sorry. Okay, that's it.
I think the biggest problem with the, like, types, classes, you know, how many of them are there,
yeah,
is just that there seems to be a bit of a lack of rigor in terms of describing what one class even is. Just
yeah.
Like,
so what they... Yeah.
So, like, it's really hard, like, when you think you found a new one, to be, like, to go back and say, are all of the ones in here not present in something existing, because the rules are not described in the same manner necessarily.
Indeed, yeah. There are a lot of these. So this classification is the one that gives you the 15. And then they've got a lot more different ways of describing these, which are not necessarily congruent to that or what. So if you want to justify the 15, I think this is how you do it. First, you classify tiles. You forget about the classification of tiles and classify the tiles. I think so you solve that problem. And then you say, for each tile, I say which of the, what is the set of tilings that it can participate in? Okay, so you get a set, and now you have a lattice, kind of partial, not really a lattice, but you have a family of sets, right? Each tile has corresponds to the family of tilings. Then you take the maximal elements in that graph of things, and you say those are the types. I think that'll work, and I think that'll get you this 15. But yeah, it would take a lot more work than has actually been done just to get a number which nobody cares about. So I guess nobody's gonna do it.
Apparently you care about
it. I can do it.
And so did you object to the R3 indexing as well? The fact that there could be overlaps, because yeah, you've got overlaps.
Yeah,
so
that's yeah, unacceptable. Yeah. So we should use this to make indices.
Yeah.
Which image of the pentagon you're gonna use. That's your point.
So whatever you want to ask is, are you going to carry on and do all the...
Oh, do the rest of them?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I don't know. Number 9 was pretty hard. I had to figure out the constraints.
Is that the one that was broken?
Yeah, the one that was broken. Yeah, because it's described... So the problem is they don't describe it in terms of, what is the configuration space of this class of pentagons? They just say things like this. This one's not too bad. Okay, so it's here. You should have these two angles adding up to pi. But where is the, is it here? Page zone. There's a bunch of other stuff in the paper which I didn't talk about, by the way. Some nice stuff about, when you group them into blocks, then what kind of tiling is the block? Maybe here again. Oh, yeah. So here's the description of type 9. So they describe these conditions that the thing must satisfy, and it is not, I mean, okay, fine, I can figure out the configuration space, but then how do you actually build a pentagon? This is not so clear. How do you find a pentagon which has these properties? Right, are there limitations on the angles? Can I just pick the angles which are not mentioned here arbitrarily? It's, no, actually there's a lot. Yeah, so, yeah, I don't know a systematic way to do it. For a while, I was trying to do those diagrams by just energy minimization. Right? They were just going to subtract everything to one side, square it, and say that the sum of those should be minimal.
Mm-hmm.
And when the user moves a vertex, just perturb the rest of them to minimize the energy. Didn't work out very well. because I don't know anything about numerical anything. And it was in JavaScript, and I was doing it on the weekend, so it didn't work out. But you can maybe do it that way. Also, I think part of the problem, I think actually for number 9, I think there's an issue where the configuration space may be disconnected. I think. I mean, maybe it's not, but it would only be like, two big lines crossing at one point. And so if you wanted to move from one to the other, you'd have to find your way to that intersection point and then work your way back up the other line, which would suck. So, yeah, so this one took a while to not do. I don't know how the rest of these are. It might be. We'll see.
any tilings you're familiar with that have 0 degrees of freedom? Like, there's like this shape tiles, and if you move anything, it doesn't move.
Maybe something like that in these later ones, actually. Maybe not. Yeah, this one seems to have some freedom in the D. I didn't look at this carefully. I don't know the Pentagons anyway. There are some. You've heard about this non-periodic tiling by Penrose with a couple of. So there's a way you can. One way you can realize that is you take. The thing starts with just like a kite shape and then a little dart shape, or simple quadrilaterals, and then the tiling goes. But you can tile the plane in a lot of different ways with those two shapes. So if you want to force the weird tiling that Penrose discovered, you have to put little lumps on the various sides to force them to lock up only with certain other sides of the other tile and with themselves. And I think once you've done that, then maybe you force the whole thing. And that is, okay, but it's not the answer because it wouldn't be rigid, right? You can fiddle with those little bumps a little bit. Okay, so
it's probably a senseless question.
No, it's good. Are there rigid tilings going on? Yes.
The question I've got is, how do you turn something that's so visual into something rigorous? Do you have any insight from reading the papers of how do you go about proving something like this? You can see it visually.
How do you prove it at a tilings? I will mention actually one thing that was mentioned as being proved in here, which is that the first five are the only ones with certain properties. So one way is you just document your methodical search. And of course, it's easy to make mistakes doing that, which is why people are fine. I don't know how they did the tile transitivity one, and there's a reference in here to a paper by Rubaum and Shepard, I think. They're both pretty big mathematicians, also very smart, and successful. The same page I just clicked on. Number three. Where they classify all tile transitive tilings of all types, essentially. Here are the 81 types of isoethyl tilings in the plane. So assume they're just methodical, and with a bit of cleverness, you cut down on the combinatorial search that you need to do. But it's only 20 pages, this paper. How bad can it be?
Expect you to be able to see things.
Yeah, I don't know, I've read it. The proof that something tiles is not that bad. So you would draw it and then you would say, like with the footsteps one or something, right? You say, okay, well, we assume that these are the same length, so they are going to match up in a way that looks like a diagram. We assume that these two angles add up to pi, so that's going to be a straight line. Right? You compute the length of it and say, okay, so that's going to. And you'll end up with, in that particular case, you'll end up with a strip that has a certain pattern of lengths on either side and angles, and it'll verify that those are the same over two sides, so you rotate and then it makes inductions and figure it out. But yeah, in general, I don't think there's any single method. Yes, new person.
Have you,
sorry,
you
that was very dismissive. Okay. That was very dismissive, though. You won't be the person. I'm sorry. Welcome.
How do you turn this into a combinatorial search? Is there any polygons?
Good question. So mercury, well, there are a few methods apparently. Mercury erasive method, by which you found the first of the one that I screwed up. Her method was to enumerate the cases where at every vertex there's going to be some of every vertex of the tiling is going to be some vertices of the pentagon coming together. That is some subset of the set of vertices, and they have to add up to 2 pi. So okay, you just pick that subset. This will impose some conditions. I think it's possible that there are vertices where A, B, and C come together, and vertices where B, E, and C come together, and you get a linear system on the angles. You solve that system, and then you try to construct a pentagon which satisfies those conditions. Some of them may be able to exclude, and some of them you'll forget, and you'll accidentally see a case. So that's one way. She also did some work with just artificially assuming, not like assuming, there are n sides of the pentagon tree. You know, these three are equal, those two are equal, and then proceed from there. Yeah, so there's a step in there where you really have to deal with the continuity of the thing, but you can get started with throwing on conditions in a combinatorial way.
Okay.
taking the auto gate from like a classification. I have no idea. No, I read this paper. Yeah. It's promising that number 15 was apparently done by computer search, which would, one hopes, be more exhaustive, or more reliably exhaustive, at least to the extent of the program, than the human attempts at systematic search in the later decades. So maybe that we're done. But yeah.
Remember
the. Yeah, I'm pretty sure they're not in the
number.
But it's still there.
Cool.
8:58. Right on time.
Nice!
Yay.